hello, you Malty Machiavelli of Montreal, Montes. Maltese? Not Montes. Maltese. Yeah. I was going to say Mounties because it's kind of Montreal, so it's Canadian. But in fact, I'm going to read it exactly so there's no confusion. Machiavelli of Montreal Maltese, and thank you to GoHabs for that malt mention. Thank you, GoHabs, and thank you one and all for joining me, Ralphy, on a lovely sunny day in the Irish Sea. And I'm out here behind the Manx Bothy to record an on-location whisky-related review for Ralphy Review 719. Now, basically, I have a bag of whiskies which I'm taking to auction. And what I thought I'd do is bring out a few of these whiskies, explain why I'm taking to the auction rather than drinking them, explain what I paid for them, and also tell you what I expect to get from them for them at auction. I'll also give you a few tips along the way, some advice on what to expect when putting your whisky in for sale at auction, because you might, like myself, be an occasional amateur multi-mate anorak flipper. In other words, you're buying a bottle of whisky which you don't intend to drink because, frankly, it might not be that good. It happens. But it is really quite collectible, and frankly, in my opinion, and it is an opinion, so take it as an opinion, there's rather a lot of whisky collectors are overly conservative about what they collect. They tend to be very much creatures of habit, driven by the orthodoxy, driven by the fashion, driven by what other people are collecting, because there's a kind of security of investment notion attached to this, which may not last over time. Right, first of all, one of the most reliable of in auctionable whiskies has got to be Macallan. I bought this about 10 years ago. You could only buy it from the distillery by post. This is Macallan Woodland Sherry Oak. Individual limited edition, estate limited, they call it. There we go. And you get this little oak leaf. Oh, that's it. Get that. Don't want it falling over and getting damaged. Collectors at auction hate damaged bottles and damaged containers. Orthodox collectors, malt mates, are looking for absolute perfection in presentation, which frankly is really quite unreasonable the older you get and the further back you go in terms of the age of the whisky, how long it's actually been in bottle. And in fact, it's worth noticing that if you see a really, really old bottle of whisky whose condition is frankly too new, too crisp, too precise, that is one indication that that bottle may be a fake. So here we are with this Macallan. We have this little oak leaf attachment. This is important. It's part, if you remove this from the package and then trying to put it into auction, you're significantly devaluing it. Any whiskey that you buy as a collector's item, keep as much of it together as possible. It is what's called provenance, and provenance gets premiums, malt mates. Simple as that. Now, this isn't a single cask Macallan. This is a batch of 1,000 bottles. This is bottle 226. It's not particularly significant as a number, but if this was bottle number one, it could be worth double, if not three times, the value of the other bottlings. The first bottle of a single batch bottling that's numbered is always the most valuable, unless there's special provenance. There you go. So that's my first of my collector's editions. I've got the receipt in this. Let's get the receipt out. And the ideal Christmas gift for Macallan fans. So it's not a receipt, it's just a little bit of provenance. But I do have the receipt in here somewhere. Here we go. wrecking my investments. And where's the damn receipt? No, this has gone and sealed shut. I'm not going to open it, otherwise I'm damaging it. It costs basically about £110, only available through the post from the distillery. You could only buy it direct from Macallan. I got in there quick, paid about £110, can expect to get about £600 to £800 at auction for this. So a very nice little collectible item. So I'm going to close this bottle now. There we go, and go on to the next one. Bona Haben Old Acquaintance. I bought this, in fact I bought three bottles, because for the age, for the age of the whiskey, 34 I believe, 34 years old, it was the oldest bottle of Bona Haben that had been released. It was £100 a bottle. And for the age of the whiskey, it was just a really, really good price. Now you're looking at £600 a bottle for this, because it's considered one of the best Bona Habens ever bottled. Frankly, I disagree with that. The last bottle that I opened for my dear old father's wake, bless him, may he rest in peace. Frankly, I wasn't that impressed with it. So there we are, Old Acquaintance. Next, we've got a distillery only bottling. All right. Now, this is Lagavulin, bottled to celebrate the Islay Jazz Festival. And this is in 2013, distilled 1995, an absolutely guaranteed investment grade single malt, because you don't get many provenanced Lagavulins. You have the official bottlings, and then you have the extremely occasional independent bottlings of Lagavulin, which frankly in my opinion are generally not very good. But the every year for the Islay Jazz Festival, which is a lot less known than Fiseal, which is the whiskey festival, Lagavulin bottle a commemorative bottling. This is it. It was bought from me by a friend, a very good friend. About £100 a bottle. I'd expect at least double that, £200 a bottle, £250 maybe. Again, the condition of the label is important. It doesn't come in a box, no presentation, but you have a lot of Lagavulin collectors. It's like Macallan. You have a number of well-heeled, financed collectors who are looking to buy certain brands. They focus their collections on these brands, whether it be Johnny Walker as a brand, Lagavulin as a brand, Springbank as a brand, or Macallan as a brand. It helps them organize and have a more bespoke collection if they focus on one distillery, and it's something you might want to consider yourself. But bear in mind, at this moment in time, some distilleries are most certainly more desirable than others. Next, we have a pretty reliable, a recent newcomer to the investment collectible scene, Glendronach. Glendronach was well and truly off the radar until Billy Walker, a whiskey entrepreneur, bought the distillery from Pernod Ricard and started bottling a range of really quite charismatic sherry matured whiskies. This is a very good example. This is 16 year old, 591, so single cask Oloroso butt, 1992. There are quite a lot of recent Glendronach fans who would go completely for this sort of thing, because it's one of the earlier releases, relatively, before the fashion for Glendronach really reached its peak. It'll be interesting to see how it sustains. But still, for what I paid for it, let me see, I paid about £80 for that, so I can expect to double £160. So it's not spectacular, but it's interesting. Do you know what? It's fun. It's fun. That's what matters. And finally, this is a real banker. This is a whiskey. I mean, all of these whiskies, I wouldn't care to open and drink, frankly. That's why I'm taking them to auction, because the money I get, I can use for buying a couple of barrels of rum, which is what my plan is. But this is it's not quite up there with Macallan, but it's certainly heading that way, purely because of the very particular, clever, smart, savvy marketing of this brand. That's what it boils down to. You know, things don't happen by chance, malt mates. Chance gets a great big helping hand from deliberate manipulations and being smart. This is a rather cloudy bottle of Karuizawa in the now famous plain box. Nothing fancy about the box, but I have opened bottles of Karuizawa and I've enjoyed them, but as time goes on, they're interesting but they're not that great. It's all about a decent malt and a good cask, and I can find plenty of that from a far, far, far cheaper price from independent bottlers in Scotland, particularly from less well-known distilleries that have got more charisma. They're more charismatic. So with this particular Karuizawa, paid £140 for £160 maybe, but I can expect over £1,000 for this. Yeah, 1982, bottled in 2012. So it's really just before the Karuizawa craze started to gain some serious momentum at auction. So, you know, timing, by the way, malt mates, is everything. So if you're planning a collection, you might consider some of your craft bourbons, you might consider some of the better quality Canadian whiskies, you might consider some more obscure mezcals from Mexico, you might consider some less well-known Armagnacs and brandies from France and cognacs from France. And importantly, that there's so much activity going on with the uniqueness of what's being produced in the American post-craft, right? Notice what I'm saying there, post-craft bourbon scene and spirit scene, that there's some really interesting stuff there which are going to grow in value over time, but they're not recognized as collectible at the moment. Okay, so it's up to you, malt mates, to do your homework, to do your sleuthing, to do your Sherlock Holmes and find out what they are, if you want to. Now I'm going to start to clear this table a little bit and conclude by giving you a little more practical advice about taking bottles to auction. First of all, don't take 2, 3, 4, or 5 of the same bottle into one auction. Because all you're really doing, malt mates, is creating your own competition for your own bottles. In other words, there might be 3 or 4 bidders online who are after, say, a bottle of Glendronic single cask. But as soon as you put 2 of the same or similar bottles into auction at the one time, you're actually dividing interest. So you could be getting less as a result at the end of the bidding. Another piece of advice is photograph your bottles before you post them off to auction, so as that you have a very good visual record of the condition of the label, of the condition of the seal, of the fill level in the bottle. Because depending on which auction house you use, and depending on who's transporting you to your whiskey to auction, there can be accidents. You know, whiskey has gone to auction by post, stored on its side, And because it's an old bottle, and because the cork is starting to shrink, which it does over time, understand that. And because the seal hasn't been able to contain it, there has been leakage, which has wetted the label, which has reduced the fill inside the bottle. And collectors, by the way, they want neck fill. They really want neck fill. There's relatively low tolerance margins for how low in the neck a whiskey can be, because bear in mind, collectors are aware that when a bottle's stored properly, upright, as the level goes down, it's alcohol that's evaporating and reducing the strength of the contents, which is diminishing the quality. Know that. Unless it's been leaking, because it's been kept in its side when in transportation, that will significantly devalue the bottle, particularly when it wets and tarnishes, damages the label. Another thing to be aware of is, if you're going to start a collection, think about it before you start. What's your motivation? And this is when you come back to Ralfy Review 719 Extras. This is what I'm going to go into in more detail. What is your motivation? What is the reasoning? What is the purposes of having a whisky collection? Because there are a number of reasons you would do it. And I want to articulate them so as that if you're planning or you have a whisky collection, you have a clear idea in your mind as to which direction you're going. But there we are. I have got a bag of whisky which I'm taking to auction. When I sell it, I'm going to buy some barrels of rum. But that, the reason for that, I am going to leave malt mates for another day, for another vlog. Thank you for joining me here outside the Manx Bothy on a lovely, bright, sunny day. Isn't sunshine wonderful? Do you know what, malt mates? I highly recommend sunshine. Wherever you find sunshine, spend a little bit of time enjoying sunshine. And one of the secrets of enjoying sunshine is to close your eyes and look at the sun, but never, ever, ever look at the sun with your eyes open, because you can damage your eyesight. But close your eyes, look at the sun, and just feel the warmth, the energy, the heat, and importantly, feel the life. Because all life, well, most life, comes from the sun. I'm Ralfy, I'm finished. Thank you for watching. Hope you've enjoyed this, and I will be back shortly. Bye-bye.